In this exercise, we will investigate the relationship between a sum of combinatonic random variables and the convex order. We focus on the following random vector. So our random vector xy has marginal distributions x and y, and they have the same marginal distributions, and x and y can either take value 0, no loss, or value 100, meaning a loss of $100. And we encounter this vector with these marginals also in the other exercise, where we investigate the independence and the mutual exclusive case. The sum s is then the sum of x and y, and we want to investigate properties of this sum s. However, we have that if we want to determine the distribution of s, we need the dependence between x and y. And in this exercise, we assume that this dependence is not given. You don't know what is the copula connecting the marginals. We had, in the previous exercise, we had investigated s independent, which is the independent modification. And we also had Sm, which was the mutual exclusive modification. So S independent and Sm denote the random variable for x plus y under the assumption that for S independent we have that x and y are independent, for Sm we have that they are mutual exclusive. So we make an assumption on the dependent structure. And for these two situations, we determined the stop-loss premium, and we showed that the stop-loss premium of the independent modification are always larger than the stop-loss premiums of the mutual exclusive modification, which implies that you have a convex order between S independent and Sm. So we had the following stop-loss curves. The green line is the stop-loss premium of the independent modification, and the red line is the stop-loss curve of the mutual exclusive modification. And then you see that between 0 and 200, the green line is always above the red line, and for values smaller than 0, for values k smaller than 0, or values k larger than 200, both curves are the same. And this proves that the independent modification is always larger in convex order than the mutual exclusive modification. In this exercise, we will repeat our analysis the same as we did for the independent and the mutual exclusive modification, but now we are looking at the random vector xc, yc, which is the combinatonic modification. And this combinatonic modification has the same marginal distributions than our original random vector. So xc is the same as x and yc is the same as y. But xc, yc, we assume it has a combinatonic copula. We know from our results on combinatonicity that xcyc is given by the inverse of x and the inverse of y evaluated in some uniform distributed random variable u. So what we need to do is we need to first determine the distribution function of x, then we need to determine the inverse. For y, we find the same inverse because x and y are the same in distribution, and then we can calculate the combinatonic modification. In order to determine the distribution function, we find that this distribution function is given by the following expression. X takes the value 0 or 100, so if we take a value smaller than 100, of course that occurs with probability 0. If we take x in between 0 and 100, then of course the probability is equal to 1 over 2. Because in that interval, the only value that x can reach is 0. And if x is larger than 100, of course this happens with probability 1, because x is either 0 or 100. Then the plot looks as follows. You have a CDF that is 0, then it jumps to 1 over 2, and then it jumps to 1. So this is the CDF of x, and of course the CDF of y is the same. Then for the inverse, we find that the inverse of x in p, of course if p is equal to 0, you find minus infinity. If p is in between 0 and 1 over 2, you are in this region here, then you find that the inverse is equal to 0. And if p is in between 1 over 2 and 1, the inverse is equal to 100. So your inverse CDF looks like this. You go from 0 to 1. You have here 1 over 2. You have something that is equal to minus infinity in 0. Then between 0 and 1 over 2, you find 0. And between 1 over 2 and 1, you find the value 100. And this is your inverse CDF. Let's now determine the joint probabilities. For example, the probability that x and y are both 0. Xc, yc, we have an expression for that. It's fx minus 1 u should be equal to 0, and fy minus 1 u, that also should be equal to 0. But if we have a look at the CDF, the inverse CDF of x, the inverse CDF of y, then you find that the inverse takes a value 0 only if u is in between 0 and 1 over 2. So this condition is equivalent with saying that fx minus 1 u is equal to 0. And of course, this condition automatically implies that also this is equal to 0, because fx and fy have the same inverse CDF and you apply it in the same distribution u. So we can write this joint statement using the single random variable u. And the probability that the uniform is in between 0 and 1 over 2 is of course 1 over 2. We can have a look at the probability that both random variables take a value 100, which is equal to the probability that fx minus 1 u is 100, fy minus 1 u is also equal to 100. If you have a look at the formula for the inverse CDF of x and y, we find that this statement is equivalent with saying that u is in between 1 over 2 and 1. Again, you have a joint statement here, but you can write it as a probability over just one random variable u. And of course, the probability that a uniform distribution is in between 1 over 2 and 1 is equal to 1 over 2. Then we can have a look at the distribution of the sum. So sc is the combinatonic sum. It's yc plus xc. And this combinatonic sum can only take two values. It's 0 or 200. The probability that the combinatonic sum takes value 0, this can only happen when both x and y are equal to 0. And we just calculated that this event occurs with probability 1 over 2. And for the same reason, we have that sc equal to 200 is the probability that xc and yc are both 100, and that also occurs with probability 1 over 2. So the CDF of the combinatonic sum, fscx, is given by the following expression. It's 0 when x is below 0, because the sc random variable can only take value 0 or 200, so it can never be negative. If x is in between 0 and smaller than 200, you have a probability of 1 over 2 to end up in that region. And if x exceeds 200, of course, the probability is equal to 1. So your CDF looks as follows. It's a CDF that is 0, then it jumps to 1 over 2, And in 200, it jumps to 1. So what we want to calculate is the stop loss curve for this SC random variable. The stop loss curve, meaning we want to determine the stop loss premiums, expectation SC minus K plus for any value of K. And we had an expression for this stop loss curve or this stop loss premium. It's an integration from K to plus infinity over 1 minus the CDF. So let's start with a first situation. We call that case 1. It's when K is in 0 and 200. So we have a K that is, for example, here. Then the stop loss premium, you can write this as follows. So instead of going from K to plus infinity, I only go to 200, because if X here exceeds 200, then 1 minus CDF is always equal to 0. Alright, so we can stop our integration in 200, and in between K and 200, 1 minus the CDF is equal to 1 over 2. So you find for this integral the solution 1 over 2, 200 minus K. We have to consider two more situations. One is a situation where the strike K is smaller than 0. It's taking negative value. The other situation is when the strike K is larger than 200. So first we look at the situation where K is smaller than 0. In that case, we look at this stop loss premium. However, SC is always larger than 0. So if K is negative, then this thing here is always positive. And we don't need to write that plus here. So we can write expectation SC minus K without the plus, because we know that SC minus K is always positive. And this, of course, is equal to the expectation SC minus K. SC is the combinatonic sum, but this combinatonic sum has the same marginals as the sum S, which was X plus Y. So this is just the expectation of X plus the expectation of Y. And the expectation of X plus the expectation of Y is, of course, equal to 100 minus K. And then you see that in case K is smaller than 0, the stop loss premium of the combinatonic sum is the same as the stop loss premiums of the independent and the mutually exclusive modification. Let's then look at case 3. In that case, K exceeds 200. We look at the stop loss premium, SC minus K plus. But we know that SC is always small equal than 200. SC can be 0 or 200, but never be larger than 200. So it means that this thing here is always 0. And the stop loss premium is always equal to 0. So the stop loss premium of the combinatonic sum is given by the following expression. If K is smaller than 0, it's 100 minus K. If K is in between 0 and 200, it's equal to 200 minus K divided by 2. And if K exceeds 200, it's equal to 0. We had the following situation. The red line is the stop loss curve of the mutual exclusive sum. The green line is the stop loss curve of the independent situation. So now we can add to this plot the stop loss curve of the combinatonic situation, and then you find the following plot. It's this blue plot here. And then you see that the blue plot is always above the green and the red plot between 0 and 200, and it's equal to these plots above 200 and below 0. So this is the stop loss curve of the combinatonic sum. So what we've shown is that the mutual exclusive sum is the safest in convex order, most preferred. Then you have the independent situation. And then the most extreme situation is the combinatonic sum. So that's captured in these convex inequalities. If you have a look at the blue and the red plot, then you see that if we take a distribution for S, any distribution for S that has the same marginals X and Y, then the stop loss curve of this distribution has to be in between the blue and the red line. Because a stop loss curve is always a decreasing convex function, so it can never be smaller than the red line, it can never exceed the blue line. And therefore we find that the following convex inequality holds. We have that S M is smaller or equal in convex order than any sum S, and that one is smaller in convex order than SC. So if we are in a situation that we are looking at two losses X and Y, we know the distribution functions for X and for Y separately, the marginals, but we don't know what is the dependent structure. Then we know that whatever dependent structure we put on top of X and Y to connect these two, I always find a sum that exceeds SM in convex order and that is smaller in convex order than the combinatonic sum. We call SM a convex lower bound and SC is what we call the convex upper bound.